There are several distinct types of standout linebackers in the NFL today. First off, you have your select handful of prototypical pass coverage studs capable of securing their zones and sticking with their coverage assignments in man schemes. Then there's the thumpers, reminiscent of the olden days, capable of laying the lumber when a runner comes within their reach while flying around the second level sideline to sideline. You also have those tasked with aiding the defensive line in pass rush situations, often anchoring the edge and attempting to shoot into the backfield for a sack. Now, it's generally believed that much like occupations in the workforce, specialization is the key to success in any industry. That may no longer ring true though, as several young up-and-coming playmakers at this position have redefined what it means to be a linebacker and what jobs they are tasked with handling. I'd like you to take a journey with me to discover the origin story of a current player who shatters the mold, an anomaly, an outlier, whatever you'd like to call it, it's something to marvel at. I typically highlight no-name players with an underdog story for my documentaries, yet this player truly battled against all the odds to overcome his own personal obstacles. Let's discover the story of Micah Parsons, who he was in the past, who he is currently, and why I believe he's destined for greatness, ushering in this new age generation of linebackers. Micah Parsons was born on May 26, 1999 in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. He was the son of Sharice and Terrence Parsons, and he had one brother named Terrence Jr. and one sister named Shatara. The three Parsons children routinely rode the bus together, their drop-off location just a few blocks from their uptown home. With frequent struggle and instability, Micah's upbringing epitomized Harrisburg. Uptown was known as one of the area's most crime-ridden and impoverished neighborhoods around that time. His siblings always stuck up for each other in ride-or-die fashion. Parsons' mother, Sharice, juggled three jobs daily to support her children, including delivering newspapers, full-timing in dental insurance, and then working at Target in the evenings. Both she and her husband, Terrence Parsons Sr., made sure their kids were all highly active in sports year-round. His dad was typically in and out for the most part, though. The family decided to move east several miles to the suburbs, seeking affordable residence in the higher-rated Central Dolphin School District. A change seemed more than necessary after his brother had been jumped the year prior. In a heartbreaking tale, Micah had known friends that died or became incarcerated, and his parents split at age 11. Food wasn't always easy to come by, as he relied on ramen, pan-fried bologna sandwiches, and giving families who opened up their homes. Micah struggled in school, as both his grade school teachers and principal doubted that he would ever succeed. He was once even called stupid by his peers in 7th grade when he failed and had to retake it. Additional criticism mounted when Micah, who was a 5-star recruit at the time, transferred to Harrisburg High for his junior season. The move was allegedly due to financial reasons with his mother, yet it heavily galvanized the area. Parsons also had a son in 2018, just before his 19th birthday. His name is Malcolm Floyd Parsons, Floyd being out of respect for his youth football coach Floyd Ham, who always believed in Micah. As for his playing career, he was a walking highlight reel. The Harrisburg native played on the Central Dolphin freshman team as an 8th grader and started for the Varsity Rams as a freshman. In his first ever game, he blocked a punt against Manheim Township in the final 26 seconds to send the game to overtime. Central Dolphin head coach Glenn McNamee said, "To say he burst onto the scene would be an understatement." Parsons was offered to join the Penn State Nittany Lions after just 4 games. He played both sides of the ball as a running back and defensive end. His freshman year, he tallied 121 tackles, 27 tackles for loss, and 18.5 sacks. Junior year, also known as his first full season with Harrisburg High School, saw less production but still impressive numbers with 69 tackles, 20 tackles for loss, and 13.5 sacks. Harrisburg went undefeated on the way to the Class 5A state championship game while he played 2 positions on the field. There was a crazy connection deeper within that game though, a future same draft, both first rounders type coincidence. Let me explain. It just so happens that the school Harrisburg High matched up against was none other than Archbishop Wood, housing a little old name in Kyle Pitts. Yes, the 4th overall pick from the 2021 NFL Draft, the same draft in which Mr. Parsons was selected no more than 8 picks later. There was even an infamous interaction between the two. At the time of their face-off, Pitts actually played defensive end while Parsons was toting the rock in the backfield. Video will show a highlight in which Pitts lifted Parsons off of the ground before slamming him into the turf to finish the tackle. You just can't make this stuff up. Archbishop Wood came away victorious, but the two never forgot that moment. In his senior year, Parsons racked up 55 tackles, 17.5 tackles for loss, 10.5 sacks, and 1 interception. But on the offensive side of the ball, he posted 1,239 rushing yards, 27 rushing touchdowns, which was 9th in the state, 99 receiving yards, and 2 receiving touchdowns. As if that versatility wasn't jaw-dropping enough, he also played varsity basketball for the school. As previously mentioned, he was a bona fide 5-star recruit. He was ranked number 4 in his class by 24/7 Sports and number 7 by ESPN. He was a must-have, floating atop the radar for schools with the likes of Nebraska, Georgia, Oklahoma, Alabama, Penn State, and Ohio State. Due to a college game day incident involving a picture with Kirk Herbstreit, Ohio State had violated rules pertaining to contact between recruits and former student athletes in the media. As a result, they then agreed to stop recruiting Parsons. Penn State had offered way back during his freshman year until he decommitted in the spring of 2016. He eventually committed again in December of 2017 and graduated early to expedite the enrollment process. The 6'3", 235-pound gifted athlete chose to take his diverse portfolio of talents to Happy Valley. Parsons was informed by head coach James Franklin that he would be playing at the middle linebacker spot rather than his accustomed role of defensive end from high school.
Right now we don't have a defensive end committed to us. We're going to play Micah Parsons at Mike linebacker. This spring, see how that goes. We know he can move back to defensive end, but we're going to have him here for spring ball and see if he can do that. So right now we don't have a defensive end committed in the class. Micah, I think what helps him is you watch him play running back. I always think the best linebackers played high school running back as well. You know, there's really a lot of similarities in terms of our running back hitting the hole and the instincts of knowing what hole to hit and a linebacker knowing how to fit. It's very similar.
Despite the fact he was a true freshman, the starting spot was up for grabs according to Franklin. In 13 games, he was only given the starting nod once. He was the first Penn State freshman to start at linebacker since Cam Brown in 2016, and he had a solid day, totaling 7 tackles, 2 tackles for loss, and a strip sack. Somehow he managed to lead the entire team in tackles, 83, while also topping on 4 tackles for loss, 1.5 sacks, 10 quarterback hurries, and 2 forced fumbles. He racked up 14 tackles, 1 tackle for loss, and a strip sack against Kentucky in the Citrus Bowl of 2019. When Big Ten Freshman of the Year voting had concluded, Parsons landed second, only behind wideout Rondell Moore. In his sophomore campaign, he started 12 of 13 games at middle linebacker, totaling 109 tackles, 14 tackles for loss, 5 sacks, 26 quarterback hurries, 5 deflected passes, and 4 forced fumbles. Against Pittsburgh, he collected 9 tackles, 2 tackles for loss, a pass breakup, and a hurry, which earned him the coaching staff's Defensive Player of the Week. In their matchup against Michigan, he tied his career high of 14 tackles and was again named the Defensive Player of the Week by the coaching staff. When facing the Buckeyes, he registered 10 tackles, 2 tackles for loss, forced a fumble, and recovered a fumble in the third quarter. The very next week, he was named Defensive Player of the Week yet again versus Rutgers in the season finale. In the Cotton Bowl Classic against Memphis, Micah went absolutely nuts. He tied a career-high 14 tackles, a career-high 3 tackles for loss, a career-best 2 breakups, 2 sacks, and forced 2 fumbles. This performance helped him reach the 100 tackle mark, which hadn't been reached since Marcus Allen in 2016. He was named the Cotton Bowl Defensive MVP after this masterclass performance.
We'll come down to the team who had a defensive stop, defensive turnover, and we got one late when we needed it, and we ended up finishing with one, so real great, real momentum changing.
Parsons then went on to be named the Butkus Fitzgerald Linebacker of the Year, which is given to the best Big Ten linebacker of the season. On top of that already impressive resume, he concluded the year as a consensus All-American. There was no third-year season for Micah as he opted out of the 2020 season due to valid concerns with the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic. He also declined his remaining years of eligibility in favor of making himself available for the 2021 NFL Draft.
Dear Penn State, I'd like to begin by saying thank you. You've given me an opportunity of a lifetime to achieve my dreams and aspirations. I have made connections with my teammates that will last a lifetime, and for that, I will forever be grateful. I decided I needed to make a choice, not for myself, but my son, and those dearest to me. While I felt safe with the health and safety standards as we returned to Penn State for workouts, the potential risk to the health and well-being of my son far outweighed my urge to play football this season. Therefore, I decided to opt out of the 2020 season and prepare for the 2021 NFL Draft. I will be graduating early and receiving my degree in December. I've kept my word to Coach Franklin because leaving Penn State with my degree in hand was my main goal when I stepped on campus. In the end, there is only one LBU, and I thank you. Who's next?
Fast forward to March and Penn State's Pro Day, Micah rolled out a freakishly athletic frame. Standing at 6 foot 3 inches tall and weighing 246 pounds, he ran a 4.39 40, had a 39.5 inch vertical jump, and recorded a 134 inch long jump. Here's what draft analyst Todd McShay had to say about the former All-American. He's long and is pretty good in coverage, with plenty of range. He is an above average tackler and shows the burst to shoot gaps and be disruptive in run defense. Parsons also has the instincts and speed to blitz, tallying 5 sacks in 2019. Another 2020 opt-out, he will need to work in getting off blocks at the next level, but consider him a day one starter in the NFL. Let's take a closer look at some of the specifics that made him a must-have on draft day. Tony Pauline of ProFootballNetwork.com credited the linebacker's athleticism and explosiveness, citing his multi-directional quickness as a massive perk. It was noted that he could cover ground incredibly well with an excellent closing burst and a violent nature to his game while maintaining momentum with what appeared to be easy changes of direction that would alter his angle of attack. He was also described as forceful up the field with outstanding displays of speed and pursuit. He had no issues dropping back in pass coverage, which shuts off the corners from ball handlers and easily stays with coverage assignments such as tight ends and running backs downfield. It wasn't all sunshine and rainbows though, as there were some possible red flags in his draft profile. In the same article, Pauline discusses a hot and cold tendency when referring to the linebacker's instincts. There were also some minor concerns about his efficiency to get to the action on the play with a lackluster ability to drive through tackles and his average at best ball skills. When stepping back and evaluating Parsons as a whole, it was a glowing review for the most part. Parsons is a tremendous athlete who forces turnovers with big hits and explosiveness. He offers the ability to develop into a three-down defender, but he must polish his instincts and be quicker diagnosing plays rather than relying on sheer athleticism to get to the action. He's a scheme-versatile linebacker, though I prefer him as a traditional weak-side 4-3 outside backer. Parsons had so much sheer talent that there was an argument for him being one of the best players in his draft class by that fact alone. It was believed he had unlimited potential at middle linebacker with a lethal combination of speed and athleticism that would create disruptions in the passing game while also stuffing the run. Now, with all of that said, where would Parsons stack up on draft day? The first thing I wanted to take a look at was other players at his respective position. It wasn't the deepest class of linebackers, which only helped him stand out even more so. When evaluating the 2021 draft, there were still several notable names though. Zaven Collins out of Tulsa at pick 16, Jamin Davis, the freakishly athletic specimen at 19, Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah, who somehow slipped to round 2, Nick Bolton, who was the Chiefs' second selection at 58, and in the tail end of the third round, Ernest Jones out of South Carolina. Now that's certainly a mixed bag when looking back, but it just illustrates the larger picture of the names surrounding him in that draft. Off-the-field issues were also something NFL clubs were keeping an eye on, with some analysts saying prior incidents in his life could raise concerns about maturity and character ahead of draft night. Parsons addressed those statements point blank in an interview that same March.
Obviously, people have concerns about things that came up, but at the end of the day, I believe that I was a kid. You know, I was 17, 18. We all made mistakes when we were 17, 18. I'm not going to let a control dictate the person I am now. You know, I'm not going to let something that was 3-4 years from now dictate of who I'm becoming and the father I want to be. You know, everyone's going to learn and grow. I'm pretty sure none of you are making the same mistakes when y'all were 17, 18, or even 25. And if someone's going to judge me over that, and I'd rather not be in their program. You know, I know what type of person I'm becoming. I know what type of father I'm becoming, and that's all that matters to me. So anybody who's willing to accept my wrongs when I was wrong and accept my rights when I'm right, I'm ready to go ahead and give them my all. But, you know, if it's going to come down to something that I did in high school or, you know, something I wish I could change, then, you know, I can only control what I control and what I do forward. So that's how I feel about it.
With that interview, the stage was set. The Dallas Cowboys were situated at number 10 when the night began, and they had their eyes set on a defensive interest, particularly cornerback. There were two terrific cornerbacks, J.C. Horn and Patrick Surtain, selected back-to-back at 8 and 9 by the Panthers and Broncos. This threw a wrench into Jerry Jones' plans, and they suddenly found themselves in an uncomfortable spot. When looking for a possible trade partner, Dallas looked towards a very unlikely place, their own division rival, the Philadelphia Eagles. A deal was struck between the Hatfield and McCoys as Philly received the 10th pick and Dallas got Philly's 12th pick paired with the 84th overall selection. It was then a matter of time and the de facto default draft mentality. When your strategy flies out of the window, you take the best player available. And that's exactly what Jerry and company did, selecting the highest rated defensive player still remaining on the board. It wasn't necessarily what fans were expecting, as it was met with mixed reactions by Dallas's fan base.
I was shocked we did business with the hated Philadelphia Eagles. How dare you, Jerry Jones?
But
it worked out.
But Skip, you know this.
He walked away with an extra third-round pick, and we will see this evening how that gets utilized. It tore my guts out when your Denver Broncos, speaking of, stole Patrick Surtain II right out from under us. And I just tweeted, please, Denver, don't take Patrick Surtain. And they did it. And I knew they would do it. And yet, was my team sitting on J.C. Horn? It may have been. I don't know that for a fact. I just know I was sitting on Patrick Surtain.
The pick did make some sense, with linebackers Jalen Smith and Leighton Vander Esch experiencing regression along with the retirement of Sean Lee in the core. There was also a clear need for the Cowboys to add a dynamic talent on the defensive side of the ball, which allowed a single season worst in points allowed and nearly did the same in opponent yards allowed as well. There was much excitement, but there was plenty of work to do before the regular season kicked off. Training camp saw Jalen Smith and Leighton Vander Esch returning as their prominent returning linebackers with Francis Bernard and Luke Gifford at the team's disposal. Vander Esch missed 6 games in 2020, which cast some doubt on his reliability. On the other hand, Smith was struggling to show his consistent ceiling, which could prompt younger and cheaper options. Parsons was a breath of fresh air, alongside 4th-rounder Jabril Cox, free agent Keanu Neal from Atlanta, and Anthony Hines, all highlighting new faces in town. Despite these various additions, the overall effectiveness of the position group was still held in question. In August, the Cowboys released an unofficial depth chart listing Parsons and Vander Esch as the starting outside linebackers and Smith starting at the mic. As the dust settled, they placed Bernard behind Parsons, Gifford behind Vander Esch, and Neal behind Smith at middle linebacker. Cox was then listed as the third team mic. It's worth noting that while the starting trio seemed apparent, Parsons did take several reps as a pass rusher in camp. No matter where they planned to play number 11, there was no doubt that he would get ample time on the field as a rookie. In week 2, the Cowboys hit an unexpected road bump when DeMarcus Lawrence broke his foot in practice before their matchup against the Chargers.
Looking at a 68-week absence here for DeMarcus Lawrence with this foot injury, going to be heading to injured reserve with the designation to return later on in the year. And clearly a huge blow to the defense, their best pass rusher, their best defensive player. And you add in the fact that Randy Gregory is also on the COVID list, might not play Sunday against the Chargers. The Cowboys, who did not generate a sack against Tampa Bay in week 1, now could be without both of their top pass rushers this Sunday. Just a big blow to their defense.
This shifted Parsons back to his high school position of defensive end. He recorded his first career sack and earned an impressive 89.9 defensive grade alongside a 90.8 pass rushing grade. He played all 39 of his snaps on the D-line and had 3 quarterback hits and 4 hurries to his credit. They always knew he was versatile, but it no doubt had to be reassuring seeing him show up in a real way when tasked to do a specific job. Not bad for an outside linebacker. Tuning into week 8, Micah was a roaming menace back in the outside linebacker role. The room had shifted slightly earlier that month with the release of Jalen Smith, who had not started any of the first 4 games before Dallas decided to cut ties. Parsons flashed his lateral and downhill speed, becoming an absolute thumper with a season-high 11 tackles and 8 stops. He earned his best tackling grade of the year, 81.6, and was pivotal in the second level. His awareness was on full display as he made several intuitive jumps into the backfield to snuff out several screen passes. His range was excellent, covering what appeared to be every inch of ground, sideline to sideline, with 0 missed tackles. This was a complete juxtaposition from his week 2 highlights as he played more than double the snaps at the linebacker spot compared to the D-line. It was around this point he began not just to play regularly, but to stand out and lead his teammates on the field.
Blitz is coming. Bridgewater in trouble, and he dropped. Micah Parsons came through.
Micah Parsons, they can line him up off the ball, they can line him up on the ball. Dalton Reisner, the left guard, this is a tough matchup. Athletically, Micah Parsons is such a unique player. He's 6'4", he's 250 pounds. He can play inside backer, defensive end like he did earlier in the year. He's great in coverage. He's the front runner, defensive rookie of the year. You can't say enough good things about him, and he came up with a huge third down sack there to kind of stop the bleeding.
Week 9 had the high-flying Cowboys squaring off against the unpredictable Broncos at home in AT&T Stadium. Aside from the surprising scoreline, Parsons had himself quite a game overshadowed by the abrupt upset. He racked up a season-high 3 sacks and hit his second-highest tackles mark of 6. This game revealed his consistency to continue high production, whether it be in tackles, sacks, stops, wherever. Number 11 was week in, week out, finding ways to contribute either as a pass rusher, a middle linebacker, a perimeter linebacker, or all 3 intertwined. It's frankly unbelievable that Dan Quinn could plug this guy in anywhere on the field and he would find a way to make a play. So much for that scouting knock on his inability to find the action, because the film shows him consistently seeking the ball out. Flash forward to week 14, the debates had ceased over Parsons being defensive rookie of the year because it appeared to be a lock. The conversation evolved to new heights though, with an increased discussion tossing his name into the bona fide mix of defensive player of the year candidates. The top of the tippy top, the highest echelon, talk shows all around the country were putting their 2 cents in on whether or not the superstar rookie could pull off what no rookie had ever done except for the legendary Lawrence Taylor back in 1981.
I'm not trying to pat myself in the back, but I feel like as in the last 3 or 4 weeks, I've been trying to say this a lot. Forget rookie, defensive rookie of the year. He's already won that. Send him the award. That's over. He's in the defensive player of the year MVP conversation, in my opinion.
Talk is cheap, though, as Parsons stayed monstrously productive yet again versus the Washington football team in FedEx Field. The play of the game, if not the play of Micah's season, came with 41 seconds left in the first quarter. Washington quarterback Taylor Heinicke dropped back for what felt like less than a second before Micah burst through from his perch spot 5 yards behind the line of scrimmage. He ripped through the All-Pro Brandon Sheriff, causing an emphatic strip sack that Dorrance Armstrong was able to trot back for a scoop and score. That big play put Dallas out of arm's reach, up 18-0, and they coasted to victory. That was one of three multi-sack games for him, and it was his third forced fumble of the year. In the penultimate game of this new 18-week season, he balled out with yet another resounding statement of play. Although Dallas fell just short of victory in a 22-25 defeat to Arizona at home, the rookie graded out at an insane 91.3 PFF defensive grade. In what ended up being Parsons' final game of the regular season, he graded out at or above a 66.8 in every single category, including run defense, tackling, pass rush, and coverage. He played 75 total snaps, which was second to only his week 12 reps. In a beautiful ratio of versatility, he played 58% of his snaps at linebacker, 36% of his snaps on the D-line, 4% in the slot, and 1% at corner. A little bit of everything. It wrapped up his regular season in a neat bow.
Doesn't get talked about when it comes to Micah Parsons. We all know that he can rush the passer. He can do a lot of great things. But his ability to play in space against a guy like Edmonds and make a play like this on the, in the open field, I mean, he literally can do it all. And sure enough.
Unfortunately, he wouldn't get the opportunity to break Javon Kurz's rookie sack record of 14.5 set back in 1999 because of COVID-19 protocols that kept him out of action in Week 18. When looking back at his sensational rookie run, what are some key takeaways we should look for? At the time I'm recording this video, the playoffs haven't begun yet, so I'll only review the regular season because the playoffs and even playoff stats are entirely different animals. Case in point, look at Julian Edelman. There's an entire argument for him being in Canton based primarily off of his playoff statistics. According to Clark Judge of Talk of Fame Network, in fact, Edelman's 118 postseason catches and 1,442 receiving yards rank second only to Hall of Famer Jerry Rice. And that, his advocates argue, is enough to make him worthy of Hall of Fame consideration. No, it shouldn't. Gold jackets are not passed out on the basis of 19 career playoff games, which is what Edelman had. They're made for players with Hall of Fame careers, and there's a difference, a big difference. So with that in mind, I'll leave it to someone else to document Parsons' playoff performances upcoming. The first aspect I want to cover is the accolades. He got a Pro Bowl nod as a rookie, which was the first time a Cowboy did that since Dak and Zeke in 2016. He received first-team All-Pro honors with 46 votes from the Associated Press, the most of any linebacker. He joined elite company by being the fourth linebacker in league history to get an All-Pro nod his rookie year. He earned the highest PFF pass rush grade, 93, not just among linebackers, but amongst the entire NFL. He also prevailed as the highest graded overall starting linebacker on PFF with an 88.5 defensive grade. If you don't solely trust PFF, there are several other concrete stats supporting his high ranking as well. His 13 sacks landed him 6th in the league, his 20 tackles for loss landed him 3rd, and his 29 quarterback hits had him 3rd when all was said and done. On top of all of that, he should be a shoe-in for Defensive Rookie of the Year, as he's a landslide odds-on favorite according to sportsbettingdimes.com awards tracker. The second aspect I wanted to highlight was his unique usage via snap counts. If you'll recall a while back, I discussed the three various types of linebackers in the NFL today. I was curious to compare Parsons with other top-tier prototypes of a more specific job requirement at the position. I started off by listing the top pass rushing linebacker from 2021, TJ Watt, the presumed Defensive Player of the Year, who played a whopping 92% of snaps on the D-line with a mere 5.5% in the box. He falls into the category of pass rushers listed as linebacker on the depth chart, but make no mistake about it, his primary job is to get home to the quarterback. Now let's evaluate a prototypical pass coverage linebacker in Devondre Campbell. He played 75.5% of his snaps in the box and just shy of 4% on the D-line. The first team All-Pro surveyed the second level with blanket coverage and earned the best tackling grade in the NFL, 90.4. The final prototype to note is the thumper, aka the punisher of the football field. I evaluated another All-Pro in Darius Leonard, which revealed that he played 78% of his snaps in the box compared to 8% on the D-line. The best quality of his game is ranging sideline to sideline to make plays, and it showed with a run defense grade of 90. Meanwhile, Micah Parsons played roughly 41% of his snaps on the D-line and 55% of his snaps in the box at linebacker. So why am I throwing all of these numbers at you? Because I want you to see how abnormal this rookie was with his snaps. Look at it this way. In the medical field, doctors are more specialized than ever. They go through years of medical school just to treat a very specific part of the body. That's why the pass rushers pass rush, the thumpers lay the boomstick, and so on and so forth. All you need to know is that Parsons, with his almost 50-50 pre-snap alignment, would be the modern-day equivalent of a cardiologist who can also perform brain surgery. He was able to pass rush with the best of them, shoot the flats to wrap up open field runners, much like that of the thumper, and finally run stride for stride with his assignments in prototypical pass coverage fashion. Now, most of what I've credited him with up to this point has been physical attributes, but what's going on upstairs? Football is primarily a mental game rather than a physical one. I'd draw many more comparisons to that of a chess match rather than the gladiator death bouts of olden days. I'd be remiss not to discuss the animal kingdom here in my third and last aspect of a season evaluation.
Base, the lion's always hungry. I see you 11.
He's good. He's a good football player.
It's a recurrent theme on his social media. Animal analogies continually popped up throughout the season. "We're just showing that we're not alligators who get paralyzed after we eat," Parsons explained after their Week 16 blowout win against the football team. It was in response to claims that Dallas would be complacent with coasting out the rest of the season after clinching the NFC East title. He credits his numerous analogies to the many motivational videos that he regularly listens to. He even gave his teammate and fellow first-team All-Pro Trayvon Diggs a new nickname. It's more than just names and titles, though. It's a unique mentality, a mind of a predator hunting prey. This, paired with his competitiveness, bolstered his leadership overall as the season progressed. His personality was praised by his teammates, as he would often keep the locker room light. For years, DeMarcus Lawrence was their defense's vocal and performance leader during the Hot Boys movement in what felt like an eternity ago. But it had been a while since Dallas was this dominant on defense. Now, the unit was not anything special yardage-wise, either total, passing, or rushing. The Lone Star defense shined brightest when evaluating turnover differential. Dallas ended the season tied first with Indianapolis at a plus 14 turnover differential. They had 34 takeaways, which was the most in the league as well. The self-proclaimed Lion, leading his defensive pride, had much larger implications directly correlated to their turnover productivity than most realize. He contributed 47 pressures, fourth most, and a healthy 16 hurries, which no doubt bolstered Diggs and that secondary's numbers. His ability to drop down and blitz at a moment's notice opened pass rush lanes for others on the line to wreak havoc. Number 11 completely renovated this defense in just one short year.
You know, the defensive player of the year, those type of conversations start to happen. Are those things that motivated you, or did they weigh on you and become kind of heavy because every week you're going out and trying to make those plays in hopes of getting those things?
I would say a little bit of both. So, you know, I would say no and yes, because sometimes, and as all players, you ride that borderline of chasing plays and making plays. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I might go out of a gap to see if I can make it just off of something I've seen or I feel like I could play it. Sometimes you make it and sometimes you don't. And coach, if you make it, you ain't gonna say nothing. But sometimes you ride that borderline, and I found myself doing that towards the end. Like, mm-hmm. I was like, man, I gotta have a good game if I wanna keep sustaining what I'm doing. You never wanna put yourself in a predicament where you're choosing yourself over the team. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes you gotta learn how to.
How old are you?
22.
Golly.
So even with that thought process,
young.
Do you put more stock into it on the field when you have that mindset or in film study?
You gotta do it to both. Cause like, I would say you gotta have the awareness on the field to understand that, but then in the study room, you gotta understand like, all right, well, you gotta understand when you could take your shot. Mm-hmm.
Have you ever watched Extreme Makeover Home Edition? The show selects a family with an unfortunate situation and then they send them on a free vacation for a week. Then, when the family comes back, their home is completely remodeled. They have an elite building and design team that enlists the community's help to finish the project before their return. At the end of each episode, there's an iconic "Move That Bus" chanted by hundreds of people as the new house is revealed.
Yeah! bus move was beautiful and it was amazing, and our old house was so cramped. It had been so stressful and so chaotic for the kids. And now it's going to let them heal, to grow within themselves. It's going to be so life-changing for them.
My point in using that analogy is to compare the insanely drastic remodel Dallas's defense has undergone to one of my favorite shows as a kid. Frankly, the timeline is unbelievable. Now, I'm not saying he is the sole reason for their entire team turnaround, but I'd give him more credit than anyone else on that roster. Dallas went from a team with zero Pro Bowlers in 2020 to now a team with 5 Pro Bowlers and 4 All-Pros. A team that was 6-10 to a team that is now 12-5. Parsons became the linchpin in which the Cowboys defense could build defensive cohesion between the front and back halves. He bolstered both the defensive line and the secondary, which in turn created excessive turnovers which gave the offense more opportunities to score. It all started with him.
You know, competition level is high around all of us, so that's the one thing I like about it here.
University of Florida tight end Kyle Pitts and Penn State linebacker Micah Parsons have been pushing each other since high school.
I got the 717, Harrisburg, PA. Harrisburg, PA versus Philadelphia, PA. Who's gonna win?
The city gonna win every time. I knew him since high school. We've been in camps together.
Kyle Pitts is my nemesis. He said Philly versus Harrisburg. So you know I'm mad. Like, Kyle Pitts beat me in the state championship my junior year of high school, went against each other. So me and Kyle got a rivalry going on.
Because we knew he was a hot commodity and shut that down.
But you're the five-star.
And folded in the state game.
Mind you,
Micah was the best back in the state at the time.
And a tremendous run by number 23, Micah Parsons.
When we played, he had 23 yards. He probably ain't tell y'all that. What happened when we played him?
Don't judge him.
He ran for 23 yards. I pulled that out.
Huh?
What? Stuff.
Wow.
It wasn't nothing about 30.
It wasn't 20. It was more than 30. We could pull the stats up. I hope he's on the same division as me, because I'm hoping to get this 1-1 back.
We a public school going against a private school.
He lost.
JC, yeah, they are a private school. They recruit. Bro. They had like 9 Division I players on their team.
At first glance, Micah Parsons may seem like a typical story of success and grandeur. You see, he was a 5-star recruit in high school, a first-round selection, that he plays for one of the largest markets in football on the most popular team in America, and you think this guy probably has never had a bad day in his life. But that's one of the many reasons I chose him, because he's been misunderstood. He's been scrutinized far more than many other players his age. A large portion of people fail to see the humanity in his story. Yeah, he's a great football player, but that's not what makes him a person. A great story tells all sides, and I wanted everyone to notice Parsons not just for the glam and the limelight, but for his arduous journey, his humble upbringing of bologna sandwiches and ramen, his troubled neighborhood as a youth, his in-and-out father, his prior mistakes made, and his pride in his roots of community. He didn't just put himself on a national stage, he put his mother, his family, his hometown, and everyone without a platform on the mainstream. Just remember, while this man is one of the hottest names in pro sports right now, he represents so much more. This video was a blast to make, and I gained valuable insight into my own life making it. I hope you guys enjoyed it, and sub if you like the content. Take it easy!